Good evening, class. My name is Vicki Knuth, and I will be your moderator for this evening's lecture. And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school was founded as a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. We hold classes throughout the United States and various foreign countries. Our Oceanside branch was established in 1994. At this time, I'd like to introduce to you the Dean of the School in Oceanside, Dr. Dennis Volpe, and the President, Dr. Carl Emler. Now, in this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title for the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The true name of the Holy Spirit manifest in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title, which means that Elohim is a title our Creator has chosen for Himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew, Greek, nor Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that could produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in our own English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, making such names as Jesus and Jehovah impossible renderings of the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in His pure spirit state symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize Himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you how everything on this chart abides within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of Him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within Himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, and that means having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now this form could only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested Himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there is only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time He walked the earth plane? And a further understanding of this name and title can be had by reading the preface of a Holy Name Bible. Now also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel up out of Egypt, He called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. Yahweh later instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. The pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle. In this school, we show proof how everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. We have 10 primary constitutional aims or objectives, and they are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as He really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without the distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Three is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Four is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern, both practical and occult science. Five is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Six is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seven is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eight is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered under the sons or children of Yahweh. Nine is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained. There is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And 10 is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. Tonight we'll be dedicated in prayer by Dr. Bruce Geller. We'll have a scripture read by Dr. Jerry Geller, which will be Proverbs, the 16th chapter. And the designated readers will be Bruce and myself.
Good evening. Let us all bow our hearts and minds, and let us first thank Yahweh for all the many blessings that You have bestowed upon us, Yahweh. We're so grateful that You have given us an opportunity to lay hold on eternal life and being recipients of that nature, that divine nature of Yahshua the Messiah, which is the Holy Spirit. We thank You for just sitting us down here and softening our hearts up and making us accept the truth and love the truth and love You. And we can't thank You enough for giving us that drive and that motivation to want to be a part of that glorious body of Yahshua the Messiah. And we ask that You keep us on the straight and narrow and continue to love the truth and preach it with everything that we've got in us. In Yahshua the Messiah's holy name, we offer this prayer. Let us say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Good evening, class. Tonight I'll be reading Proverbs, the 16th chapter, from the Holy Name Bible. The preparations of the heart in man and the answer of the tongue is from Yahweh. All the ways of a man are clean in his own eyes, but Yahweh weigheth the spirits. Commit thy works unto Yahweh, and thy thoughts shall be established. Yahweh hath made all things for himself, yea, even the wicked for the day of evil. Every one that is proud in heart is an abomination to Yahweh. Though hand join in hand, he shall not be unpunished. By mercy and truth, iniquity is purged, and by the fear of Yahweh, men depart from evil. When a man's ways please Yahweh, he maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. Better is a little with righteousness than great revenues with outright. A man's heart deviseth his way, but Yahweh directeth his steps. A divine sentence is in the lips of the king. His mouth transgresseth not in judgment. A just weight and balance are Yahweh's. All the weights of the bag are his work. It is an abomination to kings to commit wickedness, for the throne is established by righteousness. Righteous lips are the delight of kings, and they love him that speaketh right. The wrath of a king is as messengers of death, but a wise man will pacify it. In the light of the king's countenance is life, and his favor is as a cloud of the latter rain. How much better is it to get wisdom than gold, and to get understanding rather to be chosen than silver? The highway of the upright is to depart from evil. He that keepeth his way preserveth his soul. Pride goeth before destruction, and an haughty spirit before a fall. Better it is to be of a humble spirit with the lowly than to divide the spoil with the proud. He that handleth a matter wisely shall find good, and whoso trusteth in Yahweh, happy is he. A wise in heart shall be called prudent, and the sweetness of the lips increaseth learning. Understanding is a wellspring of life unto him that hath it, but the instruction of fools is folly. The heart of the wise teacheth his mouth, and addeth learning to his lips. Pleasant words are as a honeycomb, sweet to the soul and health to the bones. There is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. He that laboreth, laboreth for himself, for his mouth craveth it of him. A wicked man diggeth up evil, and in his lips there is as a burning fire. A froward man soweth strife, and a whisperer separateth chief friends. A violent man enticeth his neighbor, and leadeth him into the way that is not good. He shutteth his eyes to devise forward things, moving his lips he bringeth evil to pass. A hoary head is a crown of glory, if it be found in the way of righteousness. He that is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he that ruleth his spirit than he that taketh a city. The lot is cast into the lap, but the whole disposing thereof is of Yahweh. Proverbs, the 16th chapter.
Okay, just a couple of, I want to announce our visitor from the South Chicago branch, Mrs. Wright, and we're happy to have you here again with us. We thank you for coming down. Let everybody know that there's going to be a seminar in Chicago the week of April the 10th for anybody that's out there that might be viewing us and consider on going. It's a worthwhile venture. So I thought tonight I would just ask before we call anybody to find out if there are any questions that maybe we can entertain for anybody here in the room. No? Everybody's good? Okay, so for the first speaker tonight, I want to call on Mel Knuth.
Good evening, everybody. I have a little trouble with my ears. They were plugged up, no worse than normal, so. Read down here, 16:6. Yeah.
By mercy and truth, iniquity is purged, and by the fear of Yahweh, men depart from evil.
Okay. I just wanted to talk about the word truth. Almost every class we get into, you'll hear people talking about the truth, and it's been on my mind a lot. And Joshua has showed me how simple it can be if you allow it to be. Now, first of all, just kind of set it up of where I'm coming from is that when I've talked to friends or family about this gospel, and a lot of the reaction is that they can't get away from me fast enough or change the subject or whatever because they don't want to hear it. And to me, it's just a mind-blowing is that here you can offer somebody the truth rather than a lie. And you would think that people would want to know a truth, you know. But they just don't want to hear it. And you would think that your family or friends, if they thought enough of you, they would listen to you. But surprisingly, you'll find that they're not going to want to hear the truth, unfortunately. And it's just, like I said, it blows my mind as to a fact that here you can offer somebody a truth and you can prove it. It's not just saying, I have the truth. And a lot of religion in the world, as you all know, they all claim to have the truth. But here we say we have the truth and we'll prove what we're saying. And you try to get people to see that, and they don't want it for whatever reason. I know that the world has been turned off by religion because, like I said, everybody claims they have the truth, and you can see the
hypocrisy.
Thank you. That's what I wanted to say in the whole thing is because they just, once you start seeing, especially when you come to here and we start pointing out the difference of what we have and what the world has, it really opens up your eyes. This is the point I'm trying to make is that truth, we talk about it all the time, and there is only a lie, which he's the father of the lie, and the truth is Joshua offering you. Now, he says, where is that scripture says that the truth will let you free, and I am the truth. And
I am the way, the truth.
Yeah. Well, anybody know where that is? But anyways, now, Joshua came in to bring truth, to cast out a lie. And he is the truth. If you take and allow the truth and look the truth up when we present it to you, that's part of him. If the truth, if you accept the truth, you're accepting Joshua. And if you take and allow him to show you the proof and the truth, he will put, because he is the truth, and that soul, his spirit is going to be put into your soul and save your soul. Because he's allowing, you're accepting the truth, which He's got to open up your heart and mind to see that. But like I said, to me, it's so simple. Is why would someone not want to hear the truth? And so that's what was on my mind, is that
John 8:32.
I want to try to bring this out. How he showed it to me, that it blasts me, because I've thought about it for a long time. But he was showing me so much of where, how the truth and a lie, and how he is the truth, and his. When you accept the truth, you're accepting him. Mm-hmm. Okay, and that spirit will quicken you and allow you to accept truth, because I call him our buddy, and you guys heard me call him that. He's our buddy, not really, but he likes to be our buddy, and he'll be beeping in your ear all the time, saying, that sounds kind of hokey. I don't know if I can accept this or that. He'll also be beeping in saying, I don't want to accept this or that. And this is why we come to this class, is because we can provide you with the truth. And go ahead and read that and see if you'll.
John 8:32. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free.
Okay. So anyway, the point is that if you accept truth and if you check it out, it will set you free. It will not. He will not have hold on you to make you fall. And that's what you do. He wants you to fall. And you don't want to have this spirit in you in the end. You want to be able to accept and become righteous. And the only way you're going to become righteous is accept the truth, accept Joshua, and allow him to put his spirit in you, if it so be that you're going to be one of the chosen. That's, we're talking about predestination the other night a little bit. And so you have to get into a little more on that. But, man, I'm spinning my wheels like normal. But like I said, trying to talk to your family, your friends, and whatever. Dave, I don't know if you've talked to anybody yet, and been kind of rejected or that. But be prepared, because they're going to reject you. My family did. My friends that did. They don't want to even allow me to try to show them anything, and I wish I could do more, but
do you want, I am the way, the truth, and the life?
What's that?
Do you want where Joshua says, I am the way, the truth, and the
yeah.
life?
Yeah, mm-hmm.
14:6.
I got it. Okay. Joshua saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
Okay. Yeah, we talk about how he said he is the light. Well, light and light and life and the truth, it all synonymous is the fact that it goes with truth. I don't know how, I'm not a teacher. You probably already know that, but it's just beautiful. And Dennis was talking about it just the other night, is that you didn't just happen to come down here. Believe it or not, If you stay around here long enough, I'm talking to you, Dave. If you stay down here long enough, you'll see how you were brought into class to learn. And we hope that you stay. And because we're concerned about your soul, believe it or not. We want you to see what we see and investigate what we're telling you. And, you know, you'll come to the same realization as the rest of us that are here. That's what the common bond in this mismatch of people. You start meeting all the people from all over the country, and you'll see the diversity. But the one thing that has each and every one of us here is we wanted to know the truth. I wanted to know what the Bible said. That's how I ended up coming to the class, because I tried reading it. I tried going to church. I tried all that. And I cried out to the Creator because I wanted to understand. And I literally begged Him to show me. And one thing led to another, and it ended up I came to class, and I felt right at home. And I sat, I always come and sat right in the front seat because of my hearing. I wanted to hear everything, and I wanted to not be distracted. And I was just blown away with how they were taking, and they were putting everything together. All right, everything was fitting together like a jigsaw puzzle. It was tightly fitted. And it didn't have any cracks in it from when I was in class, when I first came into class. And that's what blew me away, was how all this information and every class was leading right into the next. For me, I could just see how everything was going, and that there was no error in it. And the things that I looked up, I didn't look up everything. You know, there's no way that I looked up everything in these years that I heard. But when you start catching on to how it all fits, and then you start seeing that there's other things that are brought out, you can go back to the things that you've already know are true, and you can see how they fit. And that's why... again, when you start seeing Joshua, how much power that he has to give you a delusion, because everything is so simple and it's so tight, and it's hard to believe that people can take and be astray from this. And I know that I'm just spinning my wheels here, but... just stay in here. You can't be in a better place. And when I came into class, there was one thing that was said to me, that this would be the toughest thing that I'd ever have to do. And what it is, it's not the information that's tough. What's tough is you. Because you will start to find out how you fall short, and our buddy is going to always be beeping in your ear. He'll never stop. He's relentless. And so you just have to fight and just keep remembering that you want to know the truth, and whatever happens to you, just stay Joshua. Like, I know this is your name, Yahweh and Joshua. I know that's your name, that's the truth. If it's the truth, then I can see these other things, how they fit, and just stay in there. I mean, you know. don't know how what else to say. Like I said, I'm not a teacher. I wish I could, but I like staying behind the camera because then I can just sit and listen. But I do talk to people out in the world, though, and surprisingly, I can do a much better job, it seems like, not under the pressure of being in front of people and the cameras and the whole thing, but, and Yashua will talk to you. Just remember, your soul is at stake, and don't let anybody ever talk to any other, anything else, because it's your soul, and you have to be diligent that you want your soul to be saved. I that's what keeps me going, is I just fall short all the time, and I just want to be pleasing to Yahweh and Yahshua. But hang in there. You were brought down here for a reason. And those people out there in Cyberland, just ask to know what the truth is. And the truth, that'll get you where you need to go. And don't let anybody tell you any difference, because Yahshua has got your back. If you accept the truth, He'll take care of you. One way or the other, He'll take care of you. So.
And our next speaker this evening will be Dr. Diane Emler.
Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
It's good to be here. I enjoyed what Mel had to say, and when someone gets up on the floor and speaks from their heart, there's nothing more beautiful. It doesn't make any difference if it's for 2 minutes or 2 hours. It really doesn't make any difference, but when it's said from the heart, you got it. You're right on it. So thank you, Mel. Carl and I were talking the other night. We do that on occasion. And years and years ago, let me just back up a little bit. If you look under the definition of salvation, one of the definitions is to be safe. Now, years ago, Carl and I talked, and at the time, we were both working, and I was in corporate America. Carl was working in a system of the university, which has a great deal of stress involved. He had stress all the time at work to get projects done. I worked, enjoyed my job, but there always was the backstabbing or who was going to do what. Same. And you both, when we were away from our home, You experience the world sometimes in its rawest form.
Yeah.
You go out in the world and you're fighting traffic, you're fighting people's attitudes, it just seems like a constant battle day after day. But our home was a safe zone. And what I mean by that is that we openly talked about that when you come home, it needs to be a safe place. And what I mean by that is it's a place where you know nobody wants to do you harm. And nobody, people want you to do good. They want you, they're not going to bite your back and, I don't know why I'm having trouble describing this, but when you come home, it's safe. It's a safe zone. Diana said it's a sanctuary. It's where you should be able to come and put your feet up and know that somebody's not going to stab you in the back or try to harm you or hurt you, that you're at a place where you know someone's heart and they know you. And of course, both being in class, there's really nothing more to say. So everyone's home should be a safe home, a safe place. A place where you can come and get out of Satan's kingdom, which is the whole world. See? Go over there and get me Revelation, the 12th chapter.
The war in heaven, then?
Yes, and then I want down there, you know what I want? I want the woe unto the inhabitants of the earth. But start with the war.
Okay, Revelation 12 and 7 in the King James. I don't know what it is in the Holy Name, but I know it's different. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought and his angels.
All right, now. Before the creation of our heaven and earth, there was, before the physical creation, there was the angelic creation, which was not a physical, natural creation. See? It was angelic. Go ahead and read. Pick it up from the beginning.
And there was war in heaven.
Now, there was a war in heaven or in this angelic creation. Read.
Michael and his angels.
Michael, who was a warrior for Yahshua, and his angels did what?
Michael and his angels fought against the dragon.
Now, Michael and his angels fought against the dragon or the mystery of iniquity. Mm-hmm. Go ahead and read.
And the dragon fought and his angels.
So Satan and his angels and Yahshua and his angels fought. Right. Now, Mel was just up here telling you that there's a war that goes on. See? And as he calls it, his old buddy is always rearing up his head and ready for war. That should not exist in your safe home. See? Go ahead and read.
And prevailed not.
Now, the mystery of iniquity and his angels prevailed not. Read.
Neither was their place found anymore in heaven.
Now, the way the Bible reads is that once there was this war in heaven, there was no longer a place found in heaven for the mystery of iniquity and his angels. See? And Dr. Kinley used to talk about when we take off this flesh and move on to the next creation, which is not a physical creation, that the one thing we know for sure about this next creation is that Satan will not be there.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. See? He will never get past this veil dividing the most holy place and the holy place, because that veil designates the flesh. And he'll never be able to enter back in to the most holy place. Go back into Genesis. I guess I'm into this a little bit. I want where Adam was expelled from the garden. And what was put at the gate?
And what?
What was put at the gate?
Oh, okay.
Okay. All right. And I'm taking a couple steps back, so stay with me here. See? We're talking about Adam, see, in the Garden of Eden, and what happened to him up here. Go ahead and read in...
Genesis 3 and 22.
Okay, does that need to get picked up a little bit? My mouse's not. Mel left some brain freeze on the floor here, and I.
I'm thinking that earlier, but I didn't want to
say it. Yeah, 22 and down to 24.
Okay, so Genesis 3 and 22.
And Yahweh Elohim said, "Behold, the man is become as one of us."
Okay, so here we go. We're talking about Adam. Go ahead and read.
To know good and evil.
Now, Adam, once he touched the fruit, he then knew the difference between good and evil. See? Prior to that fact, he did not. And the witness to that is that when he was in the garden, see, there was, as we've talked about before, no condemnation. And no condemnation about the way that he looked. Now, once he touched that fruit, he then recognized that he was naked. And what did he do? He hid. He hid in the bushes. See? So all of a sudden there was a change that took place. Go ahead and read.
And now lest he put forth his hand.
Now, we're talking about Adam, and he really is representing mankind. Go ahead, and it says that he knows the difference between good and evil.
And now lest he put forth his hand and take also of the tree of life.
Now, the only way back in is if he takes forth his hand and eats of the tree of life. Read.
And live forever.
And live forever. Read.
Therefore, Yahweh Elohim sent him forth from the Garden of Eden.
So he was expelled from that Garden of Eden, which once was a paradise. Read.
To till the ground from whence he was taken.
And when he was thrown out of there, when he was in the garden, it was in the season of fruition. He didn't have to bundle up because he was cold, because it was snowing and 20 degrees out. At this point, the fruit was on the trees and it was there for the picking. He didn't have to work at it. It was provided for him. Do you understand? No work at all. See? Read.
24. So he drove out the man. And he placed at the east of the Garden of Eden.
Now, when he drove out the man, he left at the east of the garden, read.
Cherubim.
Two cherubim, or two angels.
Who
Read.
And a flaming sword.
And the angels had what?
A flaming sword. Which turned every way. To keep the way of the tree of life.
So that they guarded the way to the tree of life. And the only way that Adam was going to, or mankind was going to find the garden again, mm-hmm. paradise again, the safe home again, was to get through two angels, do you understand, with a flaming sword. Right. See? Read.
That was the end of the third chapter of John.
Okay, so...
You want to go further?
No, I think we're okay. So then Adam was cast down into the earth plane. Now go back over to Revelation.
Revelation 12:9. And the great dragon was cast out. Wait a minute, I think we should go up to 8. I don't remember if we hit it.
Okay, go ahead.
And prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent.
So from the angelic creation, that mystery of iniquity was cast out. See? And you see evidence right here in the Garden of Eden. See? Because they describe here in your book that there was a serpent that spoke to Eve. See? Someone go and get that for me. The serpent?
Yes, John. The third chapter also.
The beginning.
3:1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field.
Now that beast of the field is the mystery of iniquity. That beast. Read.
Any beast of the field that which Yahweh Elohim had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, have Elohim said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?
Now here's where the deception took place. When the serpent, and you must understand that it wasn't a snake walking around talking to Eve. If there's anything I know about the people I do know, nobody likes snakes. See? But a snake describes the nature of the mystery of iniquity. He is a cold-blooded creature, which means he has no warmth of his own. And he has to slide up on a rock and bake in the sun to get warmth. Do you understand? He slithers on the ground. He doesn't have any feet. It's not like he can get up and walk away or fly away. He just slithers on the ground. That's where he's put. Mm-hmm. See? And if you look at the characteristics of a snake, the anatomy of a snake, he has no ears, which tells you that he can't, as it were, hear. See? And I know when I grew up in the 50s and watched any cowboy movie, see, the Indians usually talked about the white man as speaking with forked tongue. Meaning speaking on both sides of their mouth. Do you understand? And that comes with a snake, with the snakes, with the fissure, and the two sides of the tongue. Do you understand? So all of those characteristics describe the mystery of iniquity. It's not like it was an actual snake. Pick it up again for me.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast.
What does the word subtle mean?
Not easily detected.
Not easily detected. Anybody else? That's it? He's not overt. He's not, does not make himself out there. He's, devious in the way he does things.
Deceptive.
Deceptive.
Cunning and crafty.
cunning and crafty.
Elusive.
That's a good one. Elusive is a good one. Now you see him, now you don't. See?
Difficult to understand or distinguish, obscure.
Obscure, difficult to understand. See? Once again, all traits of the mystery of iniquity. You know, when he has got something to say and you don't understand it, then it's usually because of something you did wrong. You either don't have enough faith, or you're not smart enough, or you're not dedicated enough. And when you really can't, then it's a supernatural mystery which no one can understand. Do you understand? Those are all very subtle things. See? So this mystery of iniquity, this snake, was the most subtle, the most deceptive. See? Go ahead and read for me.
Yea, hath Elohim said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden?
Now, he says to Eve, now didn't Elohim say not to eat of every tree of the garden? Now stop and think about this. This is the mystery of iniquity. He didn't stand up in front of Eve and say, there is no God.
That's right.
He said, didn't Elohim tell you? Not denying his existence, but didn't he tell you not to eat of the tree? Go ahead and read it.
And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die.
So the one that's in the midst of the garden, he's the one. We can touch any of them. Do you understand? But if we touch that one, Yahweh Elohim said we would die. Now, what's his reply?
And the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not kill
me. Oh! And his retort is, oh, he didn't mean that. He didn't mean that. He meant that you would not die. Read.
For Elohim does know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil.
Now he says, now you're not really going to die, but your eyes are going to be open. You're going to be like a god. You're going to know the difference between good and evil. I want you to see how deceptive this is, how subtle this is. He's making her feel as comfortable as she can be and going, you know what? You can be a god. Don't worry about what he didn't really mean that. To this day in the book, when Yahshua says multiple times that he came to fulfill, you go, oh, he didn't mean that. He meant institute. Mm-hmm. See? It's subtle. It's deceptive. Do you understand? Mm-hmm. All you have to do is get wet in water and you'll be okay. And the way I thought about it is that as long as I was really, really sorry right before I died, then I would be okay. Mm-hmm. It's subtle. It's deceptive. Yeah. Mm-hmm. You can do what you want. You won't really die. Mm-hmm. See? No. Go ahead.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat.
Now, she did eat and then gave to Adam to eat, and he did eat. Right. Do you understand? So it was that mystery of iniquity, that subtlety. Do you understand? And when they all were cast from the garden, do you understand? Then there was put here at the veil or the gate on the east side, those two angels, see, guarding the tree of life. And the only way you could get past the angels is to get past those flaming swords, right?
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's go over and finish up in Revelation.
Revelations 12 and 9. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent.
Now, the great dragon was cast out, that serpent. That's what was in that garden, that serpent.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
Called the devil.
That serpent called the devil.
And Satan.
And Satan.
Which deceiveth the whole world.
Now he has deceived the whole world
mm-hmm.
with his subtlety.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand? You have some, and I'm not saying these are good people, but you know, Hollywood has depicted the mystery of iniquity, you know, with people with their heads turning around, or great monsters, or evil-looking guys, you understand? They kind of got rid of the red tail after a while, but they're very overt, very out there, like you would know in a minute that this was the mystery of iniquity. But that's not the nature of the mystery of iniquity. The mystery of iniquity is subtle. See? I need you to keep reading. I need that.
And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent, called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world.
Mm-hmm.
He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our Elohim.
Now has come salvation and strength. That mystery of iniquity has been cast down. Read.
And now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our Elohim and the power of his Messiah.
The kingdom and the power of Yahshua. Read.
For the accuser of our brethren.
So here we are. The accuser of the brethren is cast down. Read.
Which accused them before our Elohim day and night.
Yes, read.
And they overcame him.
Now this is how the angels and Michael overcame Satan. See? This is how they did it. Read.
And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb.
Now, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. Now, what are we talking about? Aren't you, you're back here talking about Yahshua. Isn't he the Lamb?
Yes.
But before there was that Lamb, there was the Word, or Yahweh Elohim, and it says that this Word was slain before the foundations of the earth.
Great.
See? So even before, as we were talking the other class, before this got creation got up and running, I'll put it that way, there already was salvation in place. See? So they overcame this mystery of iniquity by the blood of the Lamb. Read.
And by the word of their testimony.
And by the word. This is where you were, Mel. By the word of their testimony, or the preaching of the truth, which is what? Yahshua. So the preaching that Yahshua is salvation.
Right.
Do you understand? That preaching of the truth. Read.
And they loved not their lives unto the death.
And those that preached, those that fought, those who were had the blood of the Lamb, they fought and considered not their lives. See? Just what is there to consider? When you stack up eternity against the piddly 70 years we have here,
mm-hmm.
or whatever.
Yeah, that's right.
Do you understand? Where is the comparison? What life are you willing to lay down? I am not going to lay down my soul to the mystery of iniquity, but he can have my physical life. Time has already worn it down. You understand? And when you're in pain, you know he's right on you. You understand? Right on you. See? But they fought and did not consider their own lives. Read.
Therefore, this is 12. Therefore, rejoice ye heavens and ye that dwell in them.
Now, those who are in heaven, who have fought the fight and won the fight by the blood, by the word of their testimony, and by caring not about their physical lives, I'll put it that way, even though it's not a physical creation, they didn't consider their own lives. Read.
Woe to the inhabitants.
Pick it up just one more.
Sure. Therefore rejoice ye heavens, and ye that dwell in them.
Now it's time to rejoice because salvation has come.
Right.
You know what heaven turned into?
A happy place.
The safe home.
Yes.
The safe place.
Yeah.
Understand?
Yeah.
Protected from the rest of the world. See, go ahead.
Woe to the inhabitants.
And oh, for those who are the inhabitants of the earth.
And
woe.
Of the sea.
Go ahead.
The devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time.
So now this mystery of iniquity has, and you, I'm not going to get it, but this world is his kingdom. See, and woe unto the inhabitants, or you better watch out, because he knows he has a short time. So he's working double time. Mm-hmm. To do what? To deceive.
That's right.
To make you insecure and afraid and everything else. Right. Doubt that there even is a creator. We live, move, and have our being within him. He is our very breath. But the mystery of iniquity comes around and convinces people that there is no God. Mm-hmm. Now, how deceptive is that? Mm-hmm. You know why? Oh, well, he's not in front of you. You can't. Do you understand? He'll use anything at his disposal. Now, to get back up into the garden or to the safe house or into the safe sanctuary, you got to do two things. First of all, you got to get through the two angels with the swords, and then you have to partake of the tree of life. That's the only way you're getting back. Set up from way back there. See, now, I'm not going to do this justice. In Psalms, his angels, I think it's 94, flames, sword.
Did he make some flame and fire?
Yes, thank you. Okay.
104 and 4.
All right, hang on to that. I need hang on, give me a minute. Oh, I need my Carl. Okay, so what we're going to do. I want to go back into Genesis. And I want to get circumcision. Abraham being set up with the circumcision.
Is that 15th chapter?
No. that's Genesis 17. And I don't know, Diane, where you want to start, but
17:10.
Yeah, that's where he talks about this is my covenant.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what you want?
Yes.
Okay, Genesis 17:10. This is my covenant which you shall keep between me and you and thy seed after thee.
Okay, now hang with me. We're going to tie this together. Abraham, who the Hebrews or the Jews of today refer to as their father, as law, as well as, see, Muslim faith, refer to Abraham as their father. Because Abraham had two sons, Ishmael and Isaac. And Isaac is after the lineage of the righteous, and Ishmael after showing forth the mystery of iniquity. But from a physical standpoint, those sons of Ishmael and those sons of Isaac still believe that Abraham is their father.
Right.
Understand? Yep. Go ahead and read.
Every man child among you shall be circumcised.
Now, Yahweh set up a law with Abraham that all men should be circumcised. See? Read.
And you shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskin.
Now they were to circumcise the flesh of their foreskin.
And it shall be a token of the covenant betwixt me and you.
And it's a sign or a token of the covenant between Abraham and Yahweh. See? So the act of cutting away the outer flesh, see, of the male penis, which exposes the head, see, was the sign for the covenant. So those who were sons of Yahweh had circumcision. See? How do you think they knew that Moses was a Hebrew? The movie will say it's because of some red cloth he had.
Yeah.
No, it didn't take much to find out he was a Hebrew child. You understand? Because he had the sign of the circumcision on the eighth day of his life. And those who did not were not of Yahweh's covenant. So that circumcision, see, denoted the son of Yahweh. Now, when Israel was in Egypt and they performed the Passover feast and left Egypt, came to the wilderness of Sinai and received that Mosaic covenant here in the wilderness, they were in the wilderness for 40 years. Time came that they were ready to cross over Jordan. And the first generation, I can't work with all this, the first generation had passed away in the wilderness. And it was the second generation that was to go over into Egypt, or into Canaan's land, see? Now, when they crossed over, see, Joshua, who led them up, who actually was Joshua, who led them up through the Jordan River, they came here on the other side, and there was something they had to do. See, can somebody find that in Joshua?
The circumcision.
Joshua, the third chapter, I believe.
You're at the flinty rock?
Yeah.
Yes.
So.
And it's in Psalms or something, too.
Oh,
Carl, Psalms 114:8, if you'll remember that.
I
I need the circumcision.
You need a sharp stone.
At the fifth chapter.
Yeah, 5 and about 7.
5 and 7.
I got it.
Okay.
And their children, whom he raised up in their stead, them Joshua circumcised.
Now, so what we're talking about is the children of Israel passing through Jordan here into Canaan's land. And Joshua said that they needed to be circumcised. Now, there's a whole lot entailed with the circumcision, but I'm just going to get one point. So go ahead and read.
You need to go up to 2, 5 and 2.
5 and 2?
Mm-hmm.
At that time, Yahweh said to Joshua, make these sharp knives and circumcise again the children of Israel the second time.
So when they came up here, they were supposed to get sharp knives. To do what?
There's a margin for
them. To circumcise the males, they use sharp knives. Now, what do you have in the margin for that?
2.
Anybody have anything?
I do.
No.
In the margin, it says knives of flint.
So the knives that were used for the circumcision were knives of flint.
That word sharp.
Okay, so it was flint. Sharp knives are flint knives. Sharp knives for the circumcision like a knife.
Yeah.
Only it was flint. Where have you heard anything about flint? Don't you use flint in a lighter?
Yeah.
And when you, do you understand, rub flint against something hard, what does it do?
It sparks.
You use that flint to cause fire. Mm-hmm. And what I'm trying to get you to see is that when they were circumcised here by Joshua, they were circumcised with knives or flints, or they were circumcised with a flaming sword. Mm-hmm. A sword or a knife of flint or fire. Now they needed to get past, in principle, those angels with the flaming sword. Do you understand what I'm saying? And the same way as he left these angels here, the Garden of Eden or the most holy place, typified by Canaan's land, so you had to get past those knives of flint or fiery knives. Is this making sense?
Mm-hmm.
See? So that's what they had to do to get past the River Jordan and into Canaan's land. Do you understand this? Just pick up Psalms for me, Carl, just for a...
You want Psalm 114?
Yeah, I don't have it in front of me anymore.
All right, 114 and 8. This is where it says, which turned a rock into standing water and the flint to a fountain of water.
Oh, you can use that for next time. Not only was the stone for the circumcision flint, but the rock that he hit for the water to come out of, for them to drink, flint too. So you had fiery water, do you understand? As well as the fiery flint. Understand this?
Where was that, Carl, again?
Psalms 114 and 8.
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so we're, it was a wrong thing to call, but something you may want to use in the future. Yes. So, I'm going to try to cut this up because I'm slaughtering it. So, Carl, or anybody, I need that angels are as a flame of fire. There's one in Psalms and Hebrews, both.
Psalms 119, I think.
And I need Romans 2 and 28. And I need that circumcision without hands.
Oh, Diane, it's Hebrews 1 and 7.
Okay.
And the angels, he saith, who maketh his angels spirits?
Now, I left you here at the River Jordan with the fiery knives, the knives of flint. And in the book it reads that Israel was hardened in their hearts, see, and hard heads, see. So if you get that flint next to that hard heart, do you understand? It's going to cause a spark, see. Now, there's different examples for sure, but we're going to just get to the end of this, and that being that when Yahshua came and fulfilled the law and the prophets, you understand, and ushered in a new covenant, see? I don't know if you've ever read this chart, but the first thing at the bottom of this heart is circumcision to get into the next stage. So it's circumcision without hands of the heart and mind. I would like that scripture.
Scripture should be up there.
No, it's not.
No.
It's not. Okay. If anybody has it.
How does the scripture work in
dice? The circumcision without hands.
Circumcision made without hands.
Oh, that's over with Paul.
Putting off the body.
That's over with Paul. I think it's in, I want to say Colossians, but I'll get it for you in a second.
Colossians 2:11.
Yeah, 2:11.
There we go. And you've got Hebrews with the ministers. There's one in Psalms. Do you get a cross-reference on that?
You want me to read Colossians?
Which one do you want first, man?
Wait a minute. Let me see what... What time is, oh, it's 8:30.
No, that's not wrong.
We got about almost 20 after 8.
Okay, I didn't change my watch. I was confused. All right, I'm going to try to pull this together. I need to get off the floor. But this, I'm going to tie it up, but I want you to appreciate that you should go in there and work with this because it can be a whole lot prettier than what I've done. All right. Okay. Now, we're in Colossians 2:14 with Vicki here. Go ahead.
2:11.
All right.
In whom also you are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands.
Now, here, they were circumcised with those fiery knives. This was a type and a shadow, see, of the true circumcision that was going to take place, not, do you understand, in the flesh, but as it were, in the spirit.
Right.
See? Go ahead and read. Pick it up again, Vic.
In whom also you are circumcised with the circumcision made without hands.
Now, after you, we're not expecting you to line up in the door and we've got sharp knives waiting for you. That's not happening. Do you understand? But now there's a circumcision done without hands. Read.
And putting off the body of the sins of the flesh.
Now this circumcision cuts away the body and the sin of the flesh. Read.
By the circumcision of Yahshua.
Now this circumcision is done by Yahshua without hands. Got any more?
And you, being dead in your sins, in the uncircumcision of your flesh.
Now, in your uncircumcision, you are dead in your sins. This, we're not cutting away the foreskin of a organ of the body. What we're doing is cutting away the hard-hearted sin that every one of us walk in here with. Mm-hmm. The sins of the flesh. Now we have to cut that away, not with knives, do you understand? But Yahshua himself will do it through the preaching of the gospel.
Yeah.
You understand? Go ahead and read.
Hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses.
All right. Now, I need Psalms.
Oh, I'm sorry. I had Hebrews.
Hebrews is fine. Go ahead.
Hebrews 1:7. And of the angels, he saith, who maketh his angels spirits?
Now, remember, the angels left at this gate. See? With the swords. See? Now he has left his angels what?
His angels, who maketh his angels spirits and his ministers a flame of fire?
Now, his angels now in the spirit are flames of fire. And what cuts away our ignorance, our theories, our concepts, our opinions, but the preaching of the gospel by Yahshua. That is the circumcision done without hands. See? Now get it in, is there any more there, or just go to Psalms?
We're in Psalms?
Psalms 104:4.
I got it. Oh.
I guess he doesn't have it.
104:4. Who maketh his angels spirits, his ministers a flaming fire.
Yes. So once again, it's the preaching of this gospel now that circumcises you without hands. And once you go through that circumcision, I want you to recognize that you've gone through the trial of the angels with their fiery swords. See? Now what is left is to partake of the tree of life, which is Yahshua the Messiah. See? He's the stem out of the branch of Jesse. He is a tree. He is the tree of life. So we must all submit ourselves to that circumcision, see, in hopes of getting back and partaking of the tree of life and coming into the true safe house, the true home, the true place where there's nobody there to do you wrong. Do you understand? So with that, I want to thank everybody for the help with the scriptures, and I hope that something got across. Thank you.
And our next speaker this evening will be Dr. Dennis Volpe.
Okay, there was a lot of things brought out.
A lot of good things brought out. And I'm going to work with just a couple of points that were just made. A couple things that struck me. Now, I want to go back to that scripture, Genesis 3:1. Now, one of the things that we're trying to get people to understand when they first come into this teaching, that it is imperative that you learn to discern spirits incarnated in a physical body. People think, oh, what are you talking about? There are two mysteries in operation. There's the mystery of iniquity, which is referred to as Satan and his angels, and there's the mystery of righteousness, which is the Holy Spirit or Yahshua, and both of these mysteries are operating down inside the veil of the flesh. Now, Diane read, before we get Genesis 3:1, go back over again to Revelations, the 12th chapter, the war in heaven. Now, this is something that it's important that you start to recognize. Our founder was very, very adamant about us learning how to discern one of those two mysteries operating within a person. And it takes a sharp eye, and I don't mean a natural sight eye. I'm talking about an eye of understanding to be able to discern the difference between the two. The problem is that this mystery here, ladies and gentlemen, is going to not look on the outside like anything special. Over in the book of Isaiah, the 53rd chapter, it said that there was no beauty or comeliness about him, that when we look upon him, there would be nothing to be desired. So on the outside, he looked ordinary or plain. But on the inside, he was full of riches, of wisdom and understanding and knowledge. This one is going to try to look something other than what he is. This one is going to try to appear on the outside to be the exact opposite of what he is. So you got a problem. If you're looking at the outside of the body here, you're going to miss him. If you're looking at the outside of the body here, you're going to miss him too. Because both of them are not showing on the outside who they really are. It requires you to be able to see on the inside. And that's what I want to talk to you about a little bit. So, go ahead and read that, first of all, the war in heaven.
Genesis 12 and 7. And there was war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon.
Now what you had is you had a war back here in the angelic creation. You follow? And what happened was when that war took place, there was the hierarchy of Lucifer, and his angels fought against the angels of Michael, who were commissioned by Yahweh Elohim himself. Read.
And the dragon fought, and his angels, and prevailed not.
Go ahead.
Neither was their place found any more in heaven.
Okay, read.
And the great dragon was cast out.
Now it talks about the great dragon. Now not the Satan doesn't look like a dragon, ladies and gentlemen. Those terms mean that his nature, just like we read back there that the serpent, and Diane got up here and talked about the characteristics of a serpent. Satan doesn't look like a snake. A lot of, and I know I believe this when I was raised in Christianity, that it was a snake wrapped around a tree that talked to Eve.
Yeah.
I actually thought when I was a kid, and I was told that, that there was this snake talking to Eve and she listened to the snake. Well, when Moses saw in the vision the deception that took place there, he referred to Lucifer in the same way that we would say if somebody did something that was repulsive, we'd say that rat.
Yes.
You follow?
Right.
Or, you know, you would make a term about, not that they look like a rat, but they're, you know, they have these characteristics that, or somebody does something sly, you'd say that fox.
Right.
Not that they look like a fox. Do you get what I'm trying to say? Now, here we got the dragon. A dragon is one that breathes or shoots fire from his mouth. Now, Diane just got up here and talked about those flames, the fiery serpent. I mean, the flames of fire that he maketh his ministers as flames of fire. Now, what was coming out of Lucifer's mouth had the ability to burn somebody's soul, to scorch it or to destroy it. See, and he was referred to as a great dragon. Read.
He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out.
Now, where he was cast out is into the earth. How many of you have seen any angels walking around? How many of you say, oh, I just saw this guy look like a dragon. That must have been Lucifer. You follow? How many of you seen any people walk around with wings? You follow? You haven't heard about that, have you? Well, if he was cast out in the earth, where is he? He's not over at Denny's hanging out 24/7. You follow? Read. I'm going to show you where he is.
And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now has come salvation.
Now this is back in the angelic. It says now has come salvation. Go ahead and read.
And strength.
Go ahead.
And the kingdom of our Elohim.
Go ahead.
And the power of his Messiah.
Go ahead.
For the accuser of our brethren is cast out.
So we know that Satan and his hosts were cast into the earth. They were cast out. Read.
Which accused them before our Elohim day and night.
Read.
And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb.
Go ahead.
And by the word of their testimony.
Read.
And they loved not their lives unto the death.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore rejoice ye heavens.
Okay.
And ye that dwell in them.
Go ahead.
Woe to the inhabitants.
Now listen, what does woe mean? Woe! Stop! Take note. You follow?
Definitely.
Pay careful attention.
Right.
Or woe, you got a problem. You follow?
Yeah.
Listen, woe to the inhabitants of the earth. Read.
And of the sea. For the devil has come down unto you.
Now he's come down unto you.
Having great wrath.
He has great anger, great wrath. Read.
Because he knoweth that he hath but a short
time. He has but a short time. Now listen. First of all, it talks about the dragon and his angels were cast out. Well, how many were there? Was it like 10 or 11 of them?
No.
Carl says about five. Five or six. Well, let me make something clear. The angels were created in an innumerable company. They didn't have to procreate, so we didn't have mama and papa angels having baby angels. The angels, when they were created automatically so that there was no need for any additional angels to come about. They were created in an innumerable company. Now, Dr. Kinley talked about how that the stars in our universe are figurative in the scriptures of the angels. They're celestial bodies.
Yeah.
And if you could count and tell me how many stars there are in the universe,
yeah.
You can't do that. Yeah. Those stars are a figure of... We know there's billions and billions of stars out there. That's what we know, right? Now, those stars, ladies and gentlemen, are innumerable. They can't be counted. And so listen, how many is a third of those stars?
A lot.
You couldn't count those either. So if we had Satan and his host cast out, and that's a third of the angelic host, we're talking about a whole lot of angelic beings that were cast into the earth plane. I mean... More than man could even begin to fathom or count. There's been more angels cast out of the angelic than there ever have been humans born on this planet. You say, well, we got 7 billion on the planet now. Well, what is that in respect to a third of the stars in the heaven? There's more than, 100 billion stars just in the Milky Way galaxy. And there's billions of galaxies. And this is not... particularly a huge galaxy that we live in. It's an average galaxy. Now, what I want you to realize is that those angels, they're here in the airplane, but where are they? What are they doing? Well, what you're going to find out is if you read, and we don't have time to work with it tonight, those angels are trying to incarnate in the hearts and minds of men and cause men to be influenced and controlled by their demonic intentions. And you and I walk around and have no idea of the metaphysical forces that are trying to influence us and cause us to think what we think, decide the things that we decide, and so on. And listen, both mysteries are going to operate behind the veil of the flesh. Lucifer has incarnated in bodies all the way down through the scriptures. He was incarnated in Cain back there, who slew Abel. He was incarnated in Nimrod, who was one of the men that had the Tower of Babel built, you follow? He was incarnated in Pharaoh down there in Egypt, you follow? He was incarnated in the Prince of Tyre that you read about over in the book of Ezekiel. You follow? And those satanic angels and that even Lucifer himself have been incarnate in bodies, ladies and gentlemen. And the reason why they're undetectable is because they have a gift for being able to keep themselves hidden. Mm-hmm. Look, go to, first of all, 2 Corinthians 11:14.
Yeah.
I believe that's what I'm after. Now, I want you to know that those religious leaders at the time of the Messiah that had plotted against him were incarnate with satanic spirits. Satanic angels or demonic angels were influencing that Caiaphas, that was Lucifer working within that body that plotted to have him crucified. And here we've got the mystery of iniquity now incarnating in the body of religious men. Men that are supposed to be religious leaders. Look, when Moses and the children of Israel came up out of the land of Egypt, Do you realize that there was a one tribe that was set apart from the, actually there were 13 tribes. The tribe of Levi was a tribe set apart from the other 12. Is that right? And they were the tribe that was referred to as the priesthood, where the priest would operate. Well, when Moses was having this tabernacle built and they were getting ready to set up the high priest and low priest, there were men of the tribe of Levi that rose up against Moses and tried to overthrow him for a power play to become the high priest. And they were doing it behind the scenes. And in other words, the mystery of iniquity had incarnated right in the hearts and minds of those men over there. Now, you have Pharaoh and his host, which were a figure of Lucifer and his host. You had the mystery of iniquity that was incarnated in those Egyptians when they chased the children of Israel into the Red Sea. Now, when they went into the Red Sea, that Red Sea closed on them and drowned all of that host in Pharaoh. And as our founder pointed out, you can't drown a satanic spirit with water. Mm-hmm. What happened is when that sea closed in, those satanic spirits were simply disembodied from the bodies they were now in that had died, and they followed Israel right into the wilderness and then incarnated in the bodies of those men that were now of the tribe of Israel.
That's right.
And then they rose up against Moses, and they appeared to be holy men. One of them that rose up, that was a Levite, said to Moses, "You take too much upon you. Aren't we all holy? Aren't we all Levites or priests?" Well, what do you think was in that body, motivating that body to rise up against the one that Yahweh had chosen, who was taking instructions right from Yahweh himself, and then telling the people what Yahweh's will was, what he wanted done, and they rose up against them.
Right.
You could read about it in the book of Numbers. It's all in there. But I don't have time to dig it all out of there. Now watch. Here's what you got by the time, and down through the prophets. Moses, in the 31st chapter of Deuteronomy, said to the Levites, go over there and get this for a minute. I want you to see this. I want this to be clearly understood. Go to Deuteronomy 31, and I want you to get where he laid the book up into the Ark of the Covenant, the book of the testimony. And I'll tell you where that is real quick here. My Bible.
24:26.
Is it?
26
Let me get over there with you too.
Yep.
So we got chapter 31, and we're doing which verse?
26.
Let me go over there and read it. Okay. Okay, let's start at
24.
Start at 24. Come on, read it for me. I'm on the clock.
And it came to pass when Moses had made an end of writing the words of this law in a book.
Go ahead.
Until they were finished.
Go ahead.
That Moses commanded the Levites, which...
Now, who did he command?
The Levites.
And who were the Levites?
The
priests. They were the priests. Mm-hmm. They were the holy men that were supposed to guide Israel. Their job in Leviticus 10:10 was to teach the people the law and the difference between right and wrong, what was clean and unclean, and what was holy and unholy.
Right.
That was their responsibility. Now, here's the ones that are supposed to lead the people in terms of Yahweh's will, what he wanted done, and here's the ones that we're going to address now. Go ahead.
Take this book of the law and put it in the side of the Ark of the Covenant.
Now put it in the side of the Ark of the Covenant. Read.
Of Yahweh your Elohim, that it may be there for a witness against thee.
Listen, it's going to be there for a witness against the Canaanites when you get to Canaan's land.
Against
the tribe of Ephraim. Listen, I want you to put it in there. Why did it go in the Ark? Because nobody could touch it to take it out of the Ark. You understand? Nobody was allowed to touch that because it was holy. If you touched it, you would die.
Right.
Therefore, once it was placed in there, it was unremovable.
Untouchable.
Well, does that work? Because I make up words too.
Yeah,
it sounds good.
You always have to check me when you're playing Scrabble with me. Now, it was unremovable. And it was to be a witness against them. Why? Why did he want to set up a witness against the priest? Read.
For I know thy rebellion.
He says, I know your rebellion. Read.
And a stiff neck.
And you have a stiff neck. Read.
Behold, while I am yet alive with you.
Oh, yeah, while I'm here and you're all already saw the ground swallow up the last bunch that gave me any grief. If all, if you were standing there and you saw 250, there was 250 men of renown.
That's right.
That rose up against Moses, and he drew a line in the sand and said, all with me on this side and anybody else on the other side. And the people that are on the other side, the ground opened up and swallowed them up. It was all done.
That's true.
Yeah.
You follow? Now, if you were standing there while this guy was alive, you're going to be a little bit, you would keep your mouth shut after that. Because you know he's got some pull with the one up top. I mean, the one that was at the top of the mountain. Get what I'm trying to talk about? Read.
You have been rebellious against Yahweh.
Now, you've been rebellious against Yahweh. Read.
And how much more after my death?
And how much more are you going to all of a sudden rise up after I'm gone? See, we know something about that. We've seen those that have risen up since our founder took it off. See? Hey, while he was here, everything was kept hush.
Right.
Because when the king was in, nobody was messing. Read.
Gather unto me all the elders of your tribe.
Now you gather all the elders of your tribe, of the Levites. Read.
And your officers.
Read.
That I may speak these words.
And I want to speak these words. Read.
And call heaven and earth to record.
Now I'm going to call heaven and earth to record or be a witness against them. Read.
For I know that after my death.
I know when I'm gone.
You will utterly.
You will corrupt yourselves, read.
And turn aside.
He didn't say, I suppose you might do this.
No.
It's a possibility you're going to do it. He said, I know you're going to do it. Well, how did he know? Because when Yahweh took him up in that mountain, Yahweh Elohim, he showed him things that were going to happen too. Not just what happened behind, but he also showed him some things were going to happen forward as well. Read.
And turn aside from the way which I have commanded.
And you're going to turn aside from the way, or in other words, what I've taught you.
Mm-hmm.
Read.
And evil will befall you.
And
in the last
evil
day.
Will befall you. Now listen, here's what happened, because we're not going to have time to read it all. When Moses died, then later they come over here to Gilgal that Diane worked with, where they were circumcised before they went in and took the land and had their place of their inheritance. But by and by, what rose up were, down through the books of the prophets, were false prophets and priests that were corrupt, just like Moses said. It wasn't somebody that wasn't telling, or in other words, tried to perpetuate himself as being holy. If it wasn't somebody who was just coming in there selling something like a trick salesman, it was the holier religious leaders that were corrupting the people. It was the priests and the prophets.
Yes.
And Yahweh had to send the righteous prophets, those that had that would deliver his word, against the false prophets and those people that followed the false prophets.
Yes.
I can run examples, but I don't have time. And then he sent the prophets to warn the priests that despised his name, that stopped teaching the people his law. You follow? It's all down through there. So now when we realize that what the mystery of iniquity has done, he's incarnated in the bodies of men and covered himself in a way to make himself appear to men as being somebody that was holy. You follow? That's what we're going to read about now over here in 2 Corinthians 11:14. But before you read it, I just want to mention one thing. Yahshua warned the apostles that there would come in into the congregation grievous wolves that would be dressed in sheep's clothing.
Yeah.
That would try to devour the flock. So in other words, after the time that Yahshua, just like after Moses was taken out of the scene, that's when these false prophets and priests rose up. Well, the Messiah was telling them that that would happen after he was no longer visible.
Right?
Right? And that's what ends up happening after the apostles set up the congregations, the apostasy came. where they turned against the things that were originally taught to them by the apostles. Now, this is what Paul is warning about here. Read.
2 Corinthians 11 and 13.
Go ahead.
Excuse me, 11 and 14.
All right.
Or 13. For such are false apostles.
Now, here Paul says, for such are false apostles. Read.
Deceitful workers. Transforming themselves.
They're changing themselves or transforming themselves. Read.
Into the apostles of the Messiah.
In other words, they're trying to look like they're apostles of the Messiah, or that is to say, righteous men. Read.
And no marvel.
Now, no marvel. Don't think that's any big deal. Why?
For Satan himself.
For even Satan himself will what? Transform.
Transformed into an angel of light.
He'll appear to be an angel of light. Somebody that'll guide you. Somebody that you can look up to. That seems to be all full of wisdom and knowledge and understanding. Read.
Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as the ministers of righteousness.
Now his ministers are going to be transformed to the ministers of righteousness.
Who then shall be according
to. So this mystery of iniquity, what he does is he incarnates in a physical body, and then on the outside makes himself look like he's an apostle. He's a minister of righteousness. And because you don't have knowledge, you don't have understanding. If you notice, we have painted this side of the chart with a black background. Now, in this tabernacle that we have here, we have a woman painted. This is all of mankind that is being misled by the devil. This is the devil and his bride. This bride is in darkness, which means she doesn't have any knowledge or understanding. Therefore, when he speaks, she has no way to discern whether what he's saying is true or not. Mm-hmm. By keeping her in darkness, and we know the Catholic Church calls herself the Mother Church, and we have the Holy See, which means the congregation of souls that are. Look, you're kept in darkness. You don't know what's in the Bible when you walk in the door. When I was a Catholic, being raised, I was never encouraged to read the Bible. In fact, we were told in the church that I went to not to read it. Because it was to be left to the interpretation of the priests, bishops, and the cardinals. Right? So I never bothered reading it. Because one, and I'll tell you the reason why they didn't want you to read it. Because if you started reading it, you realize a lot of things you're reading in there is contrary to what they're telling you. And next thing you know, you're starting to ask questions. How do you think the Protestant Reformation happened? People start to say, wait a minute, here's a point. Next thing you know, they're starting to question the Pope and they're breaking away from the church. The trick is to keep keep his subjects in darkness. Then he can be their only guiding light because he appears to be an angel of light. Now this woman is kept in darkness as opposed to this woman who is painted in this tabernacle that is the bride of Yahshua. She has the sun over her head. She is brought into the light of how the purpose and plan of Yahweh work so that she has knowledge and understanding, thereby able to discern whether something is true or not. Now look, let's go over back to Genesis, the first, third chapter, the first verse again.
Genesis 3 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field.
Now what we know, one of the qualities of the mystery of iniquity is that he's subtle. Now I went into the Bible, Strong's Concordance, to look up the definition of subtle. It means to be cunning and crafty. Now, here's what cunning means, ladies and gentlemen. I got a Merriam-Webster on this. Okay, well, in here, the definition first to start with for a subtle is hard to notice or see, not obvious. Mm-hmm. Clever and indirect, not showing your real purpose. Mm-hmm. Having or showing skill at recognizing and understanding things that are not obvious. Mm-hmm. Now, listen. There's another thing in here, too, that I thought was pretty good. Well, that might have been in the Strong's Concordance. But at any rate, highly skillful, subtle. You follow?
Yeah.
So in other words, when somebody's subtle, they have a skill. They're artful and crafty, it says. Now I want you to see what cunning means, okay? I'm going to put this in my Merriam-Webster here. Cunning means dexterous or crafty in the use of special resources, right? It means characterized by trickery, cunning schemes. You follow? So somebody that's cunning has the ability to set up, you follow, a plan or a purpose. See, it says here, crafting the use of special resources or attaining an end. You follow? Characterized by trickery. So somebody that's cunning has a plan. They got a reason, a purpose. You follow? Now here's what crafty means, because crafty is another term that I want you to see. Oh boy. Crafty is the art of using subtlety, which means it means the art of marked by subtlety and guile. Mm-hmm. It's an art form, ladies and gentlemen, of beguiling somebody or deceiving somebody. And clever and useful, usually a deception or dishonest way. That's what crafty means. Now, if the devil is more subtle than any beast of the field, it means he's cunning and he's crafty. He knows he has a plan in mind, which is not going to be obvious. And he's going to use trickery to try to get you to go along with what he's saying. That's what he did to the woman there. And crafty is he's going to devise the way that he will be able to implement his deception. See, and we read that in the mystery of righteousness, there is no guile.
No.
He doesn't plan to deceive. He doesn't have an intent to cause you to be not showing his purpose. In fact, what he does when he brings you into the light is reveal to you his purpose, his intentions, his plan. This one never reveals his hand or shows his hand. Never admits what his purpose is. And he uses, just like a magician, uses sleight of hand. Mm-hmm. What they do is they're very crafty. In fact, that's their craft, is magic. And what they try to do is get you to look here while they're doing something over here, so that you don't notice what they're doing here. You're looking at at the other hand, so to speak. And so what you've got with the mystery of iniquity is, see, and Diane got up here and talked about that serpent having that forked tongue. Mm-hmm. He's able to use by his speech to get you to think he's directing you in the right direction, while all along he's misleading you.
Yes.
And he takes advantage of your weaknesses and your naiveness. And Diane talked about how that they didn't know knowledge of good and evil prior to the eating that fruit, which means they were naive, they were innocent. They weren't accustomed to lying, being lied to or deceived. They'd never been deceived. So he took advantage of that. Now the only protection you have against the mystery of iniquity, of not being beguiled, is for you to gain knowledge and understanding. That's why in this class we tell you it's important for you to check out what we're saying. To do the work and read it for yourself. Get a witness so that you know that it's accurate. And when you do, then your confidence is not in the speaker. It's not in the individual. It's in the information that you've now had proven to you that you know for yourself. That's how you weigh then when this one speaks, if it lines up with what has already been established or proven. You follow? Now I want to show you an example of something real quick. I want you to go to Acts for a minute. I want you to go to the 13th chapter of Acts. And I want to show you that something happened over there with Paul, the apostle, because Mel got up here and talked about, he talked about trying to talk to his family. So I want to go to Acts. Let me see, am I in Acts here? No, this isn't it. I'm in the wrong book here. So I got to go over to Acts the Apostles. I got to go to the 13th chapter. And I'm going to start around, 6. Let's see 6 here if that's 13, it. 6? Let me see. I got to look at it. I got to see what it is. All right, start at 6, real quick.
Acts 13, 6. And when they had gone through the isle unto Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer.
Now, there was a sorcerer. You know what a sorcerer is? Somebody that tries to use magic or whatever, just like, if you've ever saw the movies there, they have the sorcerers that can perform magic to dazzle you. Read.
They found a certain sorcerer, a false prophet, a Jew, whose name was Bar-Jesus.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Which was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus.
All right. Now, Sergius Paulus must have been a Roman. That sounds like a Roman to me. And this guy was a Jew, though, and he was a sorcerer and a false prophet. Read.
Right. Which was with the deputy of the country, Sergius Paulus, a prudent man,
mm-hmm.
who called for Barnabas and Saul and desired to hear the word of Yahweh.
Now, this guy wanted to know about what they were teaching, this ruler, Sergius. Read.
But Eliamus, the sorcerer.
Now, the sorcerer.
For so his name by interpretation.
Go ahead. He withstood them.
Seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith.
Now, he didn't want the guy believing. That's what the mystery of iniquity has got in his heart. Read.
Then Saul, who was called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, set his eyes on him.
Read.
And said, oh, full of all subtlety and all mischief.
Now you're full of all subtlety and mischief. Read.
Thou child of the devil.
Read.
Thou enemy of all righteousness. Wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways?
That's what the mystery of iniquity does. He perverts the ways of Yahweh. He doesn't deny them, he perverts them. You know what pervert means?
Twist.
He twists them and uses them inappropriately.
Right.
Read.
And now, behold, the hand of... Oh, wait a minute, did I skip something? And said, oh, full of subtlety and all mischief. Okay. And now, thanks, 11th verse, and now behold, the hand of Yahweh is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season.
Go ahead.
And immediately there fell on him a mist and a darkness, and he went about seeking some to lead him by the hand.
That he was smitten with blindness. Now that's the type to show you that the mystery of iniquity is being put in chains of darkness, held unto perdition reserved. Read.
Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, believed, being astonished at the doctrine.
He was astonished at the doctrine. You follow?
No.
That's what I just want you to realize. I want you to see the characteristics of the mystery of iniquity and how subtle he is. His job is to pervert the doctrine of Yahweh and to prevent you from receiving eternal life. That's what his intentions are. See? Now with that, we're out of time, so I just want to say we will be here again, I believe, next Tuesday, same time. We thank everybody for coming down. We thank our viewers for watching. And I'm going to turn it back to the moderator, and she will dismiss us with a doxology.
Let's all rise for the doxology. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Alleluia.
thanks for the personal touch, man.
The what?
Mel, thanks for the personal touch.
The what?
Personal touch.
When you kind of made it up.
Right.
You know what I mean.
Yeah, I know.